Father, we just come before you, Lord, and you've heard several requests, several issues in people's lives, Lord God. And I just ask, Lord, your will would be done in their lives, Lord. We pray for the healing of their bodies, but your will, Lord God, whatever it is, needs to take place, Father God, to bring you glory and honor, I pray, Lord. Lord God, there's several unspoken requests. I ask that you would be with those also, Lord, and be with our worship team and our pastor today as we bring you glory and honor. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You didn't pray long enough. I didn't have time to turn my mic on. All right, let's praise the Lord.
I have found His grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, I am free, yes, free indeed. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full.
Rise and true.
me your ways, that I may walk with you. Show me your ways. I put my hope in you. The cry of my heart is to love you more, to live with the touch of your hand, stronger each day. Change my heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. Change my heart, oh God, make it ever.
Good morning. How are you?
Good.
Hey, you know what? I know that there are people who would never stand up and say something during our sharing time. And so this morning, I'd like us all to stand. All of us, please stand. and look around towards somebody you feel pretty comfortable with, not somebody new, somebody you feel pretty comfortable with. And I would like for you to share with them one place, just one of the 100 places you have seen God at work this week. One place. Are you ready? Okay, I'm going to give you a on your mark. I don't have a gun, so on your mark, get set, go. I've seen God at work just in safety of travel. And you know, people were great. It was great. I did. So much. So much. So good to be with our kids, and we had all right. See, get you started. Just get you started. Come on back to wherever it is you're going to sit. Maybe you're going to sit someplace different than you were sitting a few minutes ago. I don't know. I did. I heard that. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to us. He is. God is good every day. Well, let's pray together. Lord God, all those things that we heard, you are at work. You are here. You are near. You are touching those who hurt. You are giving hope to those who feel hopeless. Thank you, Lord, for using these people to accomplish your purposes and your mission. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, I know we are anxious to get up here this morning, and then maybe anxious to get out. Come on up, kids. Look at you guys. There you are. Does anybody know what this is?
Piano.
Very close. Very close, yes.
Xylophone.
A xylophone. It is. It's a xylophone. You know, it goes like this. It has to sit down on something. And do you know, in the passage that Pastor Ken is going to preach from this morning, it is a hammer. I'll show you what it's for in a minute. The Bible says to encourage each other with songs, psalms, and hymns and spiritual songs, which is what we do every time we come into worship. We encourage each other with songs and hymns, or psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. See if you know this one. Let's see. Oh, it could be. It's not quite Twinkle Twinkle. You want to hear it one more time? You are right, Betsy. And you know it because of the combination of those notes and the time that I played each one of those notes. If I did... it would be a completely different song, right? It would be. We could maybe write our own song. We could maybe make it say something that's important to us. I was hoping somebody would ask. Okay, play the green dots. Just the green ones. Mm-hmm. Remember, twice there. Very good. Very good. I'm encouraged. Are you encouraged? Yeah. Yeah. We'll let somebody else have a turn. Okay, it's one, and then two, and then one. Okay, got it? Green one. Oh, there you go. You got it. Are you encouraged? Anybody else? Come on. Yep, twice. You learned something, didn't you? It doesn't work if you hit it on the knobs. You have to hit it on the keys. And you can make up different songs with different notes. Are you encouraged? Yeah. Can you, and this time we're going to sing it with no accompaniment. Are you ready? Oh, well, one more. Different person. Come on. Come on. Green. And hold it way back here. I don't know. Let's try it this way. One more time. Are you encouraged? Yes, because everybody can sing a song to encourage other people. And you guys just proved it. Let's try singing it. Oh, can we sing it that high? Let's go to a little lower with this. Jesus loves me, this I know. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Are you encouraged?
Yeah.
Me too.
Now kids too.
Now, in a second. In a second. Everybody gets an instrument of their own to take with them.
Yay.
So you can pick one, and you can thank me later.
Money!
Yeah, skip the money. Just the instruments. No money. Just the instruments. You have to figure out how to use it to make a joyful noise to the Lord. You're waiting so patiently. Thank you.
have money inside.
There is, but no money today, just instruments. Tanya, did you leave Sarai home on purpose this morning? Did you know about that? Apparently, somebody forgot that it takes money to make the world go round. And it takes participation on everybody's part. So this morning, as you give your gifts and give your tithes to the Lord, I hope it brings joy to your heart. And know that what you do is going to encourage someone else. Lord Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for how you've blessed us, because you are so good. And we thank you that you've encouraged us to encourage one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, and with generosity of spirit that allows your work to move forward. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you do for us. And we pause in this moment to give just a little bit of a gift to you. In your name we pray. Amen.
How many remember that, the song that Kim just played? Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Precious Jesus, precious Jesus, thou hast sought us, and thine we are. We are yours.
Well, this last month or so, we've been taking a journey through the book of Ephesians. And the book of Ephesians is the outline about what God expects the church to be. We are in Christ. That's what chapter one's about. All those predestines and stuff is there about Jesus is predestined to be all those things. And we, when we are saved, enter into what, into all the stuff that Jesus has. And we go on. Last week, Pastor Lori talked in chapter 4, and I really like the end of chapter 4, what it says there. Right now, we're looking at the things about, let me back up. The Apostle Paul, when he wrote letters to the churches, first part of his letters were all just about the theology, okay? Big word, but that's the thing. This is the theory about how things are supposed to go. And the last part of his letters are, and this is how you're supposed to live out what we talked about, the theory. This is the theory, this is the practice. Right now, in the book of Ephesians, we're talking about the practice of the theory that Paul talked about in the first part of the book. And so he tells us here, I'm going to get the context of what we're going to talk about, because that's one of the things we always need to do when we're, you know, looking at Scripture, is to take it all in context. And at the end of chapter 4, Paul says, get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all types of evil behaviors. Instead, be kind to each other, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God, through Christ Jesus, has forgiven you. And the first verse of chapter 5 says, be imitators of God. So you see, chapter 4 ends with us saying, you know, forgive one another, get rid of all this junk in your life, and forgive one another just as God through Christ has forgiven you, and then imitate God. So you get the context here. Is God wants all this stuff out of our lives. He is a forgiving God, and we are to imitate God, which is we are to forgive others. So, there's a lot of stuff in this chapter, but we're going to concentrate on verses 15 through 20. We got it there. So be careful how you live. This is Ephesians chapter 5, starting in verse 15. So be careful how you live. Don't live like fools, but like those who are wise. Make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. Don't act thoughtlessly, but understand what the Lord wants you to do. Don't be drunk with wine, which causes... Don't be drunk with wise, because that will ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, and make music to the Lord in your hearts. And give thanks for everything to God, the Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't that wonderful? Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for all that you have given to us. You gave us your Son so that we could be reconciled with you and enter into your family and be partakers of everything that Jesus has. Now, Lord, open our hearts and our minds to what you have for us to learn this morning. We pray this all in Christ's name. Amen. I want to get back up here to verse 15. So be careful. Don't live like fools, but like those who are wise. And then the next verse, oops, push the wrong button there. Make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. Let's look at some words here. Words are really fun. They have, you know, meanings and are important. And sometimes what we think a word means is not really what it means. There's popular meanings, and then there is what the meanings of, we call the lexical meaning, which is what you find in the dictionary. And we look at the word fool. What comes to your mind? Silliness? Is that kind of it? Somebody's acting the fool, they're acting silly, messing around and doing things, right? That's what kindly what it is. But Jesus has some harsh words to say. He says, you know, if you call somebody a fool, you're in danger of hell's fire. Wait a minute. I'm in danger of hell's fire for telling somebody they're being silly? Well, in the Bible, fool does not mean somebody who's acting silly. Psalm 53, verse 1 tells us exactly what a fool is. It says, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. So being foolish or being a fool, according to the Bible, is behaving and believing that God does not exist or that he does not matter. Think about that. It's in your attitude, it's in a person's attitude and behavior that I can get along without God. Well, he may be up there, but it really doesn't matter. I don't need him. I can do it all myself. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. So, that's the first part of our verse. Don't be a fool. The second part of our verse says, but live like those who are wise. How many thinks you're wise here? That might be considered a little arrogant, you know, if I can say, yeah, I'm a really wise person. I'm a wise man. And once again, it's one of those words that are common. Understanding of the word is, it's a guy who sits up on a mountain who dispenses all this wisdom, you know, these words that, you know, to live by and different things. But biblically, what does it mean? We have in the Bible what's called wisdom literature, which is the book of Proverbs is the main one. Proverbs and Ecclesiastes are the books which are considered wisdom literature. And it, you know, has all kinds of stuff. It talks about how wisdom has, you know, prepared the way and sends her handmaidens out to bring people in to, you know, partake of what she has. You know, and you talk about it, you know, it says another one of the verses in Proverbs says, guard your heart because it controls everything you do. That's kind of a paraphrase. But there are all these things in these books which are practical applications of what God tells his people to do. He's got the law of the Lord, and then the wisdom literature is how you take the law of the Lord and live it out in everyday life. So, my definition of wisdom is you are wise when you look at the world the way God looks at the world. Think about that. We are wise when we look at the world the way God looks at the world. And then we live according to that. So we've got the contrast here in this verse. Don't live like a fool. In other words, don't deny God, his existence, and what he says should happen in this world. And over here, it says, live like those who are wise. In other words, live like people who want to see the world as God sees it and live accordingly. Got the great contrast there. Denying God, acknowledging God. So this is what Paul is telling us here, is that we need, as God's people, to reject the fools. Reject foolishness. Once again, it's not rejecting silliness. It's rejecting the rejection of God. It's saying no to a philosophy of life or way of life that says God does not matter. And we are to embrace a way of life that says, I need to know what God has for me and how God sees the world, and I need to live that way. So Paul has it. Get rid of this. Move over to this. Why are we going to do that? The next verse tells us, make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. In other words, we are to live the way that God wants us to live. We are to see the world as the way God sees it, because the days are evil. And once again, we have a word that has a connotation. And we think of the word evil, we think of really horrible stuff. You know, I think of the Holocaust as being, you know, evilness. I've dealt with people that have done evil things. But evil is not always the worst things you can ever think of. There's more to evil than we think. We can think because a person is not engaged in horrific things. You know, sexual trafficking of children, you know, selling drugs on the corner to kids and other people, murdering people and stuff that, oh, there's no evil going on. But What does the Bible tell us about evil? Well, remember the story of Noah? You know, in the ark? Why did God tell Noah to build the ark? Because of the evilness of humanity. So he finds Noah, who is obedient, tells him to build an ark, and preaches to the people while he's building the ark, and only Noah, his wife, his three sons, and their wives enter the ark along with all the animals. So what was the evilness that was going on at that time? Well, the book of Genesis doesn't tell us. But Jesus, in Matthew chapter 24, gives us a hint. He says that when the Son of Man returns, things are going to be like the time of Noah, which we know from the book of Genesis was a time of evilness. And Jesus defines or tells us what that evilness was. They were eating and drinking. They were getting married and giving in marriage. What's so evil about eating and getting married and giving our kids to get married? There was no acknowledgement of God. Evil, like foolishness, is the absence of God or the twisting of God. Theologians tell us that evil is just a twisting of God's perfect creation. Doesn't take a lot of twisting. It is just twisting things different and making it be different than what God intended. So God intended his creation, humanity, to live in relationship with him. A growing relationship with him where we become more reflecting more the who God is. And that's what God expects of us who are his children, is that we have this growing relationship with him that reflects more and more who he is. We become more like Jesus. So, word evil, the evil of the days of today, isn't what we might think it is. A lot of people don't like the fact that we have same-sex marriage. A lot of people, that is, the epitome of evil. You know, there's a lot of things that's going on in our political climate today that one side's called evil, the other side doesn't, and this side calls something evil that this side embraces. So we have to realize that evil is a twisting of God's perfect creation. And no, within the United States today and around the world, there is no political system that is 100% good or 100% bad. Well, maybe there are some that are 100% bad. But there is no political party in the United States today that is 100% godly or 100% evil. God needs his people to be in both of those areas, living and doing the best they can. Because today, as in the times of Paul, people are living as if their God is not there or God does not matter. And they are doing things that are seemingly good, like eating and drinking, getting married, giving your kids in marriage, but done in a way that does not acknowledge God. Does not acknowledge God. Foolishness is a total rejection of God. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. The evil of the days is living as if God does not exist or God does not matter. Just going about your daily lives as if God, it doesn't matter. We as Christians are admonished here is to make the most of every opportunity. And how do we do that? We need God's wisdom. Okay? We need God's wisdom. The next verse tells us to reject things. We are not to be thoughtless in our behavior. When we are thoughtless, we are depending on ourselves to do things. We're not looking to see what God would have us to do. We all remember, most of us here remember the WWJD thing. What would Jesus do? It was based on a book that was written in the 1800s called In His Steps, where a church decides that they will not do anything without first asking the question of what would Jesus do, then doing it. That is acting thoughtfully. Because we're wanting to do what God would have us to do within a situation. And we can only know that by getting ourselves tuned in to God and what He and how He sees the world. Once again, well, how does that happen? How do I get in tune with God and know how He sees the world? Well, the Sunday school answer is we read our Bible and pray, which is true. You know, he makes a contrast here of don't be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. We've probably seen people who get drunk, and we know that they lose kind of control. We lose our inhibitions and say things. But when we're filled with the Holy Spirit, we could lose our inhibitions and speak what God would have us speak. You know, the Psalms here, hymns and spiritual songs and making joy in our hearts to the Lord should be an outgrowing of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Once again, we come to the question, how do I do this? How do I get this filling of the Holy Spirit? For each of us, it can be a little different. But what it takes is an attitude of surrender to God, saying, God, I no longer want to be a fool. I want your wisdom. And then seeking it. Seeking is another one of those words that is powerful. It's just not looking around for something. It's just not looking around for something. It's a diligent looking for something. Jesus tells us the parable of the lost coin in, I think it's Luke 14, where a woman loses a coin, was part of her dowry. And she sought that coin. In the middle of the day, she lights the lamp using precious oil. And then she gets the broom out and starts sweeping around, going into all the corners and nooks and the crannies until she finds it. That's seeking. That's seeking. So when we're seeking the Spirit, I know for me, I had to really look at my life, what God wanted me to give up, or what He wanted me to turn over to Him. And I lost nothing, really. I lost nothing. I found a deep relationship with God. I found a deep relationship with God. And so, as we are seeking the Spirit, we use the Bible. I don't have a print one, but here's my Bible. Hundreds of versions of the Bible. And spending daily time in this book, that is God's revelation to us of Himself and how He wishes to be in relationship with us and how He wishes to transform us. And then through our prayers, listening to how He wants me to be. So the verse says, taking advantage of things today. Not acting thoughtlessly, but acting thoughtfully. Asking God how I can be thoughtful in my actions today. Thinking forward to what I am sure I may encounter. You know, we all have people in our lives that we are a little challenging. And I know I've had times when I know I'm going to work and I know that this person is going to be rubbing me the wrong way today. Anybody else have that experience? I can see heads nodding. But we can think and say, okay, I know I'm going to go to work today, or I'm going to go to this place today, and I know so-and-so is going to be there, and I am pretty sure they're going to say something or do something that is going to push my buttons, and Lord, I need to act thoughtfully. Give me the wisdom and the strength to behave in a way that will reflect You. That will not reflect foolishness, but will reflect holy wisdom. That's a good prayer to have, isn't it? And then, at the end of the day, we can say, thanks, Lord. I didn't act the way I always act with that person or in that situation. Thank You, Lord, for the wisdom and the strength. Or we can say, well, Lord, I almost did it today. Help me to do it better next time. See, that is moving into a deeper relationship with the Lord. That is moving into a deeper relationship with the Lord. And as we live in a time that is, many people consider it to be a time of, you know, evilness that we have to fight against or we have to live in. You know, Paul's telling us, be thoughtful in these times because the days are evil. I am brought to mind about a psalm. It's Psalm 139. And in that psalm, the psalmist David writes, O Lord, search me and know me. You search me and know me. You know when I stand up, I sit down. You know when I'm going to say something. But near the end of the psalm, David says, Oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God. O men of blood, depart from me. In other words, he wants to separate himself from the evil people. They speak against you with malicious intent. Your enemies take your name in vain. We can kind of relate to that today, can't we? Then in verse 21 it says, Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with complete hatred. I count them my enemies. David is expressing what I hear many people express today about the evil world around us, the world that is not in sync with God. But we have to be wary there. We need to be wary of what it might do to us. We need to be immersed in the Spirit, going back to what Paul is saying about being filled with the Spirit. About being filled with the Spirit. And you know, David goes on in the last two verses of that psalm and tells us how we avoid the trap of becoming like those we hate. I don't know if I read this or if I made it up on my own, but when we are fighting to defend the truth or fighting to defend what God wants, we have to make sure that we don't become the enemies of that truth or godliness through our attitude and through our behaviors. Because that can very happen. We take the attitude of what David talks about there in the verses 19 and through 22. You know, get the wicked men away from me. They're take your name in vain. I hate them. They're horrible. But then David comes back to what he said in verse 1. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any wicked way in me. And lead me in the way everlasting. I really believe that sums up what Paul is telling us in Ephesians about don't live like fools, live like wise men, like people who are wise, seeing the world as God would see it, because we have to make our days count because the days are evil. People are living as if there is no God. We need to be filled with the Spirit and being living in harmony with other people of God. Because we ask God to search us and our attitudes to make sure that we have moved from foolishness to wisdom and that we are truly living thoughtfully. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for what you teach us in your word about living for you and being filled with your spirit, which transforms us and guides us in the way we should go, guides us into true wisdom. And may the prayer of our hearts be, search us, O God, know us, cleanse us, and lead us into the way everlasting. We pray this all in Christ's name. Amen. And with that thought of the psalm, let's go to the table together. The Apostle Paul tells us that we should not take the elements unworthily, but we should think about it. Kim, could you come up and play 516? And the rest of you can grab that ancient thing in the pew rack in front of you called a hymn book and turn to page 516. I don't want to inflict an a cappella on you. Cleanse me. Let's stand and sing this as a prayer.
Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Fill me, O Savior, know my
Isn't that a great prayer? Jesus took the bread on the night he was betrayed, and after he broke it, he gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body which is broken for you." And in the same manner, after supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood which is shed for you. Take all of you, and drink it. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you remember." We come down the center aisle. It's an open to anyone who claims Christ as Savior. If you don't, what better time to come into his family than here in the bread and the wine? You come down, take the bread, dip it in the cup, and return to your seat. Come down the center aisle and peel back around the edges. And then we'll take it together.
Thank you.
The bread that we break together is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was broken for us. And the cup of blessing that we share together is the cup of the new covenant that reconciles us with God. Let's eat together. Let's stand for a blessing. Lord, may we go out thoughtfully, because the days are evil. And let us be lights to the world around us, because we are reflecting your love to the world that is in desperate need of it. Pray this all in Christ's name. Amen.